Thank you very much for that wonderful introduction. Very pleased to be here. What I will present is first a little bit of background about the organization that I'm working for, because I think it's important to realize, because in a way this is like an initiative of civil society. So we are representing the end users, if you like. And then I will explain a little bit more about what we've been doing in terms of digital innovation in the field of history education, some of the achievements, but also the challenges that we faced, and then the lessons learned. So EuroClio is the European Association of History Educators. We were established in 1992 with support of the Council of Europe. And from there onwards, we grew to our organization with 68 associations from 45 different countries. So here you can see an impression of like our annual conference. And most of these people are really representing different countries. So in a way, we are working directly for the history educators, and we do have like the networks to disseminate the material. We have a clearly defined mission, which is to promote innovative and responsible history, heritage, and citizenship education. And during our last annual conference, we agreed also, we endorsed a manifesto on what high quality history, heritage, and citizenship education is. And here are some principles. The full manifesto is available on our website. But for example, we say, okay, there's not just one way, one correct way of interpreting the past. There has to be significance with the present. We have to embrace diversity, introduce global perspectives. But it's also very much focused on the innovation and the use of active methodologies. Traditionally, we've been working a lot with our members on the development of resources as part of like capacity building. We did a lot of work in transition countries, in, for example, Latvia and Estonia, but also in Russia, later Turkey, Bulgaria. Some of the projects have been done in a transnational way. Not all of these publications are from EuroClio. I think the French-German history textbook is the most famous example of collaboration between countries, because in a way that has been unique, especially in the countries of the former Yugoslavia. We worked on common publications, and the reason I mentioned this is that it's very it's quite different if you go beyond the national borders. Approaches for history are very different, interpretations are sometimes conflicting. So how do you deal with these differences? How do you negotiate that? Because one country's hero is the other country's enemy. And we tend to always emphasize the things we're proud of, the things that were done to us, but we have very little attention to what we have done to others, or the things that we feel are of no concern to us. But then, of course, there became like new technologies. And we felt, okay, we also had to react to that. There is now a wealth of digitized heritage available, and there are more and more tools that are being used in education. Some are specific for subjects, but most of them are not. And if you can look at like some of the logos that you can see here, it's also major companies, major initiatives with lots of money that are working on education. And very often tools such as like Skype or Google Drive have not been made primarily for education, but they're used in that way. We've been concerned that when you look about online education, there's too much focus on just knowledge. You can see that there are many quizzes where you have like the correct answer. And of course, the gaming element is a very good way to engage students. But for history, it becomes problematic if you sort of say, okay, these are the good answers. We want to make things more complex, more messy. And we were also surprised that there are very few initiatives to really promote historical thinking, which is close to our hearts. So that was another trigger. In 2008, We had Joke van der Leeuw-Roort, the founder of Euroclio, together with Maria Greven and Richard Hermans. They had an idea, okay, perhaps we can make use of these online opportunities to do something about the idea of a European textbook. There has been a lot of debate about a European textbook, but generally we thought it wouldn't be, wouldn't work in a textbook format because it's very limited. I mean, how can you deal, how can you be really diverse and inclusive in that way? How do you deal with the history of Germany, for example? We are also facing the same problems as we build Historiana, because, yeah, the collection is like growing bit by bit, and we want to be balanced. But then there's also the tendency that people immediately look, okay, what do you actually have on our national history? So, and then sometimes it's a positive story, but sometimes it's a negative story. It's very tricky to be balanced, but for sure there is much more opportunity. And we came with this idea, and with the support of the Dutch Ministry of Education, we brought together some colleagues working in the heritage sector, working in museums, working as history educators at universities, to sort of say, okay, do you think that the fact that we can now work online changed the rules of the game and it's possible? And these reactions were quite positive. So we started with the development. And here, Robert Stradling, he was a consultant to the Council of Europe, did a lot of work on multi-perspectivity. He played a leading role. He was one of the project advisors. And very soon, he said, okay, let's stop talking about it. Let's do it. And then we started the development of material. It was supported by the Lifelong Learning Program and the Anna Lindh Foundation, the first version of the website. And we involved educators from our network. So here you can see, for example, a group of educators from Spain, the Netherlands, Cyprus, Iceland, Finland, Czech Republic. And so it immediately became already very international. We also, Euroclio has a supporting role. So here we have trainees working at the secretariat, and we, as managers, we facilitate the meetings, we do the fundraising, the reporting, etc. But we also worked with professional web developers, and that is immediately a challenge, because for our mission, our relation with our members, we are insisting that the materials should be open, that they should be available for free. But on the other hand, you also have like these high users demands and big costs for web development. The first version of the Historiana website was launched in 2012. We got like recognition, amongst others, by the Council of Europe North-South Center, and we won a prize for like European collaboration for educational media. But there were also many challenges. We were very democratic in the beginning. So people, they would go for whatever they were interested in, passionate about, and they were would make case studies on that. But these were very difficult to link to the curricula and the teaching practices of most people. So this is, for example, the big picture that you can see there is about like minority rights and the rights of Sami to education. So that might resonate well here in Scandinavia. I'm not sure. It might still be too specific, but it's very far away for a country like Bulgaria. We always have in the end like a bigger picture, sort of, okay, what is this a case study? What is it an example of? So very often it's about rights issues or migration flows. But so then we can say how you can teach it in a broader context. But still, it's very tricky. Something like the suffragettes, the votes for women, is much easier to connect to the curricula. The language is also a barrier. I mean, all the material we made is available in English, but basically we're dependent very much on professional volunteers, and I think it's a good starting point to at least reduce the language barrier. And in the first project, we didn't really have like ready-to-use learning activities. It was very dense on historical context. So some achievements, some lessons learned. Luckily, we got an opportunity to continue to build the project. And we started a project with Europeana Creative. Are you familiar with Europeana?
Yeah.
Okay. So basically, a lot of material has been digitized and made available through Europeana. But the question was actually, who is going to use it and how is it going to be used? I think a question that has been running throughout the conference. So, well, we from the very beginning saw like a good connection with Europeana. If you can really access all the museums, the digital collections of museums, archives and libraries across Europe, it's an incredible asset for history educators. And we still believe that, and we're now actually leading a task force on Europeana for education to remove those barriers. But I think it's also important that we showcase what can be done with this material to give the arguments and to work together to make this, to explain why this material needs to be digitized and made available. So the challenge that we saw for ourselves is how to make best use of digital technologies and resources to promote high quality history, heritage and citizenship education, something which is at heart of our mission. So that means for us that we want to promote historical thinking, that we want to promote competence-based learning, that we want to be multi-perspective and go beyond the national narrative. And then, by now, there are actually 30 million items already available via Europeana. And actually, already from the presentations that we've seen today, you can see that there are millions and millions and millions of sources more that are not available. But are they relevant? How can we use them? Is there enough context? Can we assess the language? Is the quality high enough? Are we allowed to use the source? I think the question of relevance is very important. We already saw in the previous presentation that very often people look in different ways. So sometimes they're interested in visual. So in this case, can we catch the interest of the student? Does this source put the history in a new perspective? Those are very difficult search terms, and it's very difficult to curate for that. So part of our answer is that we've been working on the selection of sources that are useful for history educators. So it's really, so we took part of the curation and we said, okay, don't look at all the sources, look at the selection of sources, and we already do part of that. And here is an example of how that looks in practice. So we've been working on educational material on the First World War. And in this case, we were interested on how propaganda was used to portray the enemy. And here you can see that we have examples like from Britain, from France, from Russia, from Italy. There actually the whole collection is bigger, but otherwise you couldn't see anymore what the pictures are. And then you can make comparisons. And for example, well, Russian might be easier here. Some of you might be able to actually read the Russian. But for most European countries, it is actually quite difficult. So if you, the caption here, just providing the caption is not a lot of work to provide the translation if you have the language skill. It's something I'm very comfortable to ask a colleague from Russia. So these are like the nightmares of Wilhelm. And then you can see he's really afraid to be also attacked from the back. And he's portrayed as a coward. And then you have like the recurring imagery about the Germans as barbaric. That was actually a problem because when we made this collection, we found so many examples of Germans being portrayed as barbarians. But that also says something because, well, yes, they were then overrepresented in the collection, and I think we can leave some out because you don't need them all because they all basically do the same mechanism. But it's very important in the contextual information that we say that this was actually quite common. And to in some and that's actually why if you have such a set, that then in the collection as a whole, you can really draw conclusions about uniqueness. and also allow for comparisons. Another first step, and this is really in the early stage, is that we wanted people not only to find the sources, but really interact. And I'll show you an example of the first tool that we made. It was quite complex because we had to have a users registration system, a way of uploading sources, a whole new database, and all this interactivity. So now if you go to appshistoriana.eu, you can create a free account. You can, at the moment, we only have one app, but we already have funding to develop four more. You can upload your own source or select a source that we have pre-selected and then describe the information that students later will see just by yourself. So this is a bit like a speeded up version. I can't type that fast, but for the sake of presentation, I thought it would work. So this is a satirical map, actually, from the collections of the French National Museum Library. And it is a satirical map that was published in 1914 as part of rallying the war effort from Britain to get the support. It was selected because later it was used by the Germans as counter-propaganda. So that's actually, so in the exercise we ask students to first analyze why they think it would be used as propaganda by the Britons, and then later to sort of see how that changes when the Germans are using it as counter-propaganda. So as students can make selection and annotate the question. So that's the mechanism, if you like. We made the tool actually to analyze visual sources, but once we made it, we thought also of different applications. Because now you can also ask students, for example, to raise questions and to sort of say, what do you want to know? Or you can ask them to apply their own historical knowledge and say, can you annotate what you actually know about this picture? When you created this app, you can invite students, they will get an email, and they can do all of this themselves. Once they're finished, they can also see what their classmates have been doing, and they can see if you filled it in as a teacher, they can also compare their answers. So in a way, it's a very good mechanism to enable peer learning among students. And it also fits in flipping the classroom. This is something that you can ask students to do before the class in preparation, and then you can discuss it when they come back. So this is our first attempt. But you can see the potential if you have different ways, also comparing stories. It's very important that we can be flexible and that in the end we have a range of tools that educators can use. It has to be very quick to use also. The other thing, which is perhaps looks less innovative but was very much needed, is that we also started to make ready-to-use learning activities, explaining with all the materials that teachers and students need. There is one part which is actually quite innovative in my view, and that's the way we curate our collection. So here you can see that we organize the learning activities according to historical thinking, teaching methods, and teaching challenges. And if you click on one of those items, you get a short explanation about what we mean. And this is the innovation. We could only do this because we use a graph database. And we're now in historical interpretation. So if you hover over the learning activities, you can see that there are different ways of teaching about historical interpretations. So some of these learning activities will also appear somewhere else, as an example of a certain teaching method, as an example of overcoming a teaching challenge. And every time we can adapt just the one line text that explains why the learning activity is there. So in a way, this can also later be used for teacher training purposes. So now we go to the lessons learned, and that will be the final part. So what we've learned in this process is that the selection is crucial. We don't look for large quantities of sources, but those that are engaging and help them think historically and gain historical knowledge. Finding these sources takes time. If you are able, as an owner of your collection, to make that selection for or with educators, they will just go for that selection, and you can really encourage the use. Just to illustrate this point, this is a newspaper, French newspaper, the day after the assassination of Franz Ferdinand, and the headlines already changed. And that says you something about like the significance of that as an at the time. People didn't feel that the First World War was breaking out. It actually took many days later. So it's a whole process. So you can use that to question the notion and raise awareness that now everybody says, okay, when did the First World War start? Well, it started with the trigger assassination of Franz Ferdinand. Well, at that time, on that day, of course, it was headlined in Vienna still like days after. But in many countries, like life went on. And it was only afterwards when people started to declare war. So it's one source, and then you already give the like justification why this source is interesting and how people are going to use it. Linking to what is actually being taught helps. So not just say, okay, this is what we find interesting. So after our experience in the first project, we actually started to work on major events like the First World War. We are also thinking about themes like Industrial Revolution, but also the themes like migration, etc. The resources need to be quick to find and easy to use. Teachers always complain about, okay, we have so little time. I'm sure that in a few years' time, the tools that we present are going to be used everywhere because it's actually it gets easier and easier to develop those. But actually to go through the trouble of finding out what you can do with those tools and to make already like the applications and the examples, to make sure that you can share those with other educators and that they can adapt it themselves, then it's sort of the applications of the tools that will be the real asset. There are also online better ways of presenting the past. This is actually it's a web service that we use, which is a commercial service, but we can embed it, and it's like multi-stranded timelines, and it's just one example of how you can present the material. And in this case, we looked at all the key moments of the First World War, which is, well, especially in like the west of Europe, they focus just on the Western Front, and this makes you realize that there were also events happening like in Africa and Asia, on the Mediterranean Front, the Eastern Front. So sometimes when there was like a quiet period locally, you can see that elsewhere in the world there was actually a lot of things going on. So, and that's also, and you can zoom in to parts of the timeline and sort of see how all these events were interconnected. Well, licensing is very often an obstacle. I was very pleased to hear that here in Sweden there's a much more open attitude towards licensing. And yeah, we support the use of the Creative Commons because it's just another obstacle if you do have to negotiate. And in our experience, when we present our project, museums, archives, libraries are quite pleased that we use their material. But it's just all this work with professional volunteers, it's yet something else that we have to do. We need to work with educators, historians, and web developers. And this communication is definitely not always easy. It's very, even though we speak the same language, like we have English, a good level of English, we don't speak the same language professionally. So we really had to work like hard. So this is one of a photo of one of these interactions where we have like Nick from WebTech, who is our web designer, talking with educators and historians on how the tools work. So, and every time you will find out new challenges. So be prepared for that. In our experience, we found that sketching can really help to reduce the interdisciplinary barriers, just to clarify, okay, what do you actually mean? Is this what you want? So we work with, we try to postpone the actual web development as long as possible, because to redevelop something that has already been made is very costly, frustrating, and time-consuming. Like the tool that I presented is a great tool for some things, but actually, from the beginning, we knew that we educators wanted to ask like a follow-up question and to have multiple questions and to put it in a sequence. Well, if we had sketched that out before, but then in a project, you also have these time limits. We had to deliver that and make it in 1 year. So that was challenging. So in the end, I think we need to work to have an ecosystem where everybody benefits and from the use of digitized heritage in education. And this is actually taken from like the latest business model from Europeana. So I do think that is a good hub. If you can actually, if we can like figure out how that really works and it's easy to find those sources integrated in other systems so that we can acknowledge, that we can show like where the sources are coming from, but also how it's really being used. I think that would be very beneficial. Last thing I would say, just that it wouldn't be possible to do this with all the committed people. We actually never had more than one staff member working on this initiative, but we have like editors from many different countries, like history educators who are already busy with volunteering time to work on this, and a very active group of trainees at the Euroclear Secretariat. So this wouldn't be possible without them. So thank you very much. If you have